all the books.
It's time for book reviews.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Folkmaster's vlog for the Warhammer Fantasy Gaming System, created by Games Workshop based in UK. And welcome to audio drama review number 35 of this vlog. Today I'm going to be reviewing two short audio dramas called Fabius Bile, Repairer of Ruin, written by Josh Reynolds, and The Embrace of Pain, written by Ian St. Martin. So we can begin with the Fabius Bile short audio drama, which was a part of the 2014 Advent Calendar. It's performed by Ian Brooker, Stephen Collin, and Jonathan Keeble. It is what you could call a soft pilot into the Fabius Bile storyline post the Horus Heresy. We can begin to talk about the front cover for this audio drama. On the front cover, we see a reused image from the 6th edition Codex for the Chaos Space Marines. I don't like reused images like this, but for what it's worth, it looks cool. I would give it 5 out of 10 forks. The story is as follows. Lupercalia burns, the might of the traitor legions reducing the last redoubt of the Sons of Horus to rubble, and through the ruins strides Apothecary Fabius of the Emperor's Children, with an army of wild genetic experiments. But what does the twisted apothecary want in the temple to the fallen Primarch Horus, and will he find it? So this opens up right in the middle of a huge important event, which is the burning of Malleum. As it is described in the Codex Black Legion, the few surviving members of the Sons of Horus Legion lingered there during the opening salvos of the Legion Wars, or Slave Wars, if you may, where they worshipped the preserved body of Horus within a stasis field. At the forefront of an assault mainly comprised of Emperor's Children is Fabius Bile, together with the associates by the name of Haruk, whom he lobotomized, which now serves as a bodyguard. Haruk used to be the foremost apothecary to oversee the implantation of psychosurgery of the Birch's Nails within the Legion. Fabius Bile himself considers that Haruk has traded up to be in the company of Bile. One thing I found to be fascinating about the Legion Wars is that the Emperor's Children, the most undisciplined of the 9 traitor legions, were the most organized out of them all and the most powerful under Fabius Bile's rule. They worked their way through the Monument, the last bastion of the Sons of Horus. Now, I must say I'm surprised that the burning of Malleum and the collecting of Horus' body would be a story told only in a short audio drama. I actually think it could have been a perfect novella to tell from the perspective of Fabius Bile of the Emperor's Children. A missed opportunity, but it doesn't make the story any less good. Following the Battle of Scalafrax, where most of the senior officers were killed, Fabius Bile rose to the commanding officer of the Legion's remnants. It is interesting to see him in this role. Now, it's sad that we don't get to see more of it, with the exception from a little small part in the Talon of Horus.
So, what did I think about this audio drama? Well, it's narrated by Ian Brooker, who isn't my preferred choice, perhaps for that of a narrator. But he's doing quite a decent job for it, and I would say that his raspy voice actually fits in with the setting. Steve Conlin brings the aging voice of Fabius Bile into life, and I do like that. I do like the dialogue written for him. It captures both his rise to madness and obsession.
Keep up, Harrock! We're on a shit show!
Chief Apothecary Fabius of the 3rd Legion stepped through the smoke, bolt pistol snarling, the arms of his chirurgian backpack clicking and whirring. The targeting overlay in his helmet flickered and spun across the curve of his eye, choosing targets with mechanical precision. He fired without thought and without hesitation, for all that he had once fought alongside his opponents. They had been allies once, it was true.
I think it's a neat story that continues the storyline of Fabius Bile, which was started, you could say, perhaps in Fulgrim, and which later on be finished in the Talon of Horus novel, and later on lean on and continue on in Fabius Bile Primogenitor, also written by Josh Reynolds. It do suffers from being a little short, but this is a definite recommendation I have for you. I will give this short audio drama 7 out of 10 forks.
Thank you.
And with that, we can continue on with The Embrace of Pain. It's written by Ian St. Martin, as I said earlier, and it's performed by John Banks, Antonia Beamish, Robin Bowerman, Steve Conlin, and Louis Soto. This was a part of the 2016 event calendar, and it serves also as a sort of pilot for the later on Lucius the Eternal storyline, which Ian St. Martin will write about. We can begin to talk about the front cover for this short audio drama. The front cover is that also a reused image from the Codex featuring Lucius himself. I think it's a beautiful image despite being reused. I would give it 6 out of 10 forks. The audio was also part of the collection called Champions of the Eternal War, so I can talk a little bit about that. So the image is a bit cartoonish to say the least. The story itself is broken into 3 quite different characters in a non-connected stories that featured on the CD. The Space Wolves looks the least interesting. Lucius himself looks quite weird, particularly the angle of his neck, which could be compared to the Tomb Raider neck, if you say so. But his armor looks amazing. The Iron Hand lacks any type of personality. I will give this front cover 3 out of 10 forks. Let's see what this story is all about. While voyaging through the depths of the warp, the infamous Blade Master Lucius the Eternal is challenged by a servant of another god, a champion of the old Death Guard Legion, no less. Keen to remain dominant over his preening and ambitious rivals in the cohort Nasikei, Lucius takes up his sword without a second thought. But could an unfeeling demon host of Nurgle, or the voices inside his own head, be the undoing of his Slaaneshi curse? So right off the bat is that John Banks performs the narration, and I must say, despite liking him in many other stories, his interpretation is quite boring here. He sounds a little constipated, to be honest. But I can give credit to St. Martin for his description of the ship traveling through the warp.
A frozen army of repulsive seduction focused on the warship's bridge. They watch in silence, their gaze never wavering. As a shadow falls over the diadem. They watch in silence as a new storm appears. A sprawling morass of vile corruption blooms like a diseased aurora, extending cancerous tendrils over the diadem's hull. A deluge of mucus and blood-laced pus smashes down, drowning the warship in poison even as it burns at the Gellerfield's touch.
So the story tells as the Nurgle's champion managed to infiltrate the ship and its sickness is killing the humans on board. Meanwhile, the champions of Lucius' warband is preparing for war. From numbering over 1,000 warriors, there are barely 50 of them left by this time. Lucius communicates with Clarion, described by the author as a neverborn in the body of a little girl that commands the warship the Diadem. Antonia Beamish delivers the creepy voice of Clarion, while I believe it's Louis Soto who is delivering the voice of Lucius. Now, he doesn't do a bad job, but I would have expected that a several thousand years old corrupted Lucius wouldn't sound just like that. But despite not having the special effects, he sure does have the attitude I would have expected of Lucius, and it feels like a good carryover from McNeil's portrayal of the character. Other minor characters is Whisper Tilio, which is one of Lucius' lieutenants, known as the Last Eagle and the chieftain of the Ripax Raptor cult. Then there is Cesare, the apothecary of the warband, an Emperor's Children's legionary who has been there since the founding. The last one is Crescentius, another lieutenant and former paladin blade of the 3rd Legion. He wants to kill Lucius and take the warband for himself, which is an impossible task as Lucius will not die. He is voiced by Robin Bowerman.
Eternal One, you must not...
Must?
Lucius's sword is at Crescentius's throat faster than even transhuman eyes can track.
Do tell me, what must I do? Was that the beginning of an order, Crescentius?
The humans on board are all corrupted by Nurgle into zombie-like creatures waning in pain. Lucius then comes across the unnamed Death Guard Nurgle champion. He is voiced by Steve Conlin, and they use the proper sound effects to make him sound sick and rotten. This character is given much information about who it is besides being a former Death Guard, who is now the living embodiment of a plague. It refers itself in plural form, most definitely meaning that all the Nurgle entities as the flies mix up like a big host. It's a hive of mind, to say the least. It's everything that Lucius dislikes, a disgusting pus-filled creature who doesn't feel pain anymore, one of the striving goals of Lucius and his own kind. As he hacks it to pieces, it doesn't even react other than to laugh. This creature parts and demons combines into an even bigger demon. Lucius communicates with Clarion, whom he orders to clear the embarkation deck and ventilate it into the empty void of space, and it more or less ends there. So, what did I think about this short audio drama? Well, I would say that the audio drama lacks any form of meaty story to it. We're introduced to the character of Lucius in his 40k form, but it doesn't dig too deeply into his persona, what he is and who he is now. For someone who isn't familiar with the character already before would feel something is definitely missing in this story. I would say that Fabius Bile short delivered a little better than this. When writing about a character that we already know literally has plot armor on him, it is extra important to expand about on his character and mythos, or to have exciting side characters or heavily entertaining story. Those are the things you have to surround around this plot armored character. The story is a bit lacking, the side characters are barely introduced, so I imagine and I hope that they will have a bigger part in the actual novel, which I will review later on this year, hopefully. Lucius himself passes on as a good portrayal, but I really hope that it will dig deeper into who he is. I will give this audio drama 5 out of 10 forks, and with that I'll conclude this audio drama review. Thank you very much for watching this audio drama review. Don't forget to rate and subscribe to my channel. Please give a thumbs up on my videos, and also leave comments if I'm doing good, so keep on doing them. And leave negative critique if I'm doing bad, so you can improve or remove the content entirely. And also don't forget to share this with your friends if it could be interesting, entertaining, or simply inspiring. But with that said, thank you very much for watching this audio drama review. Death to the false emperor. Bye.